God, we ask that you help us to lift your holy name up today, God, that you are so deserving of our praise and our worship, God. Lord, we ask you, we thank you for calling us over into this marvelous light, that you give us a mind to be in your house today, dear God. Because without you, Lord, we may not even have a mind. But we thank you, Father, for what you're doing in us and the work that you're doing in us, dear God. Lord, we pray that you help us to represent you in a way that others may see you, God. We ask, Father, that we want to be witnesses for you, Jesus. We want to live a life that is acceptable to you, dear God. And we can only do that through you, Jesus Christ. And we're asking you, Father, to come into this service this morning and bless us, dear God. Help us, Lord. Remember those who are on the way that are not here, Lord, that you bring them here safely, Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Our church announcements are as follows. We have Sunday school every Sunday morning at 9:30, morning worship service at 11. On Monday nights, we have prayer meeting at 7, Tuesday nights, Bible study at 7:30, taught by Pastor Boone. Wednesday is our church fast day. On Thursday nights, we have our spiritual growth class at 7:30, and Saturday mornings, we have prayer at 6 a.m. One new announcement for this week. Pastor Bowen will be preaching at Hollywood Church of Our Lord on December 6th at 7:30. And we're asking all that can go out and support, please do so. All right. Okay, we're changing, Pastor Bowen is changing the time for 6 o'clock prayer from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. Same thing I said Saturday morning. Prayer change from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock a.m. So that means if you can't make it here at 6, 8 o'clock.
That's the warning.
That's what Deacon Johnson said. Okay, so those are all the announcements at this time. Okay? December 6th. December 6th, Pastor Bowen will be preaching at Hollywood Church at 7:30. So all that can go out and support, please do so. God, we still find that there is nothing like Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. I tell you, that message last week, Sunday, just really hit home for me, you know, because sometimes we go on about our pain, about our business, and we just forget to just give God thanks just for the little things, amen? That message last week just really, really, really hit home for me, because sometimes we come in here, and you got 2 minutes to stand on, and you won't even stand and give God praise, amen? But what about that person who's guilty or who wish they were saved, amen? What about that person who somebody got to open the door for them and just get in and see, to open the door, to open the door for themselves? What about that person who didn't even get up on the floor? Hallelujah. I just thank God for the Lord for that person. Amen. I don't have time to look at what I don't have or what I need. I just thank God for what He has allowed me to be with Him.
If you find anything in my heart that's not like you, Lord, I want you to take it away. Hallelujah. And fill me, oh God, with you, Lord Jesus. Not just any old thing, Lord, but fill me with you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Empty me, Lord. Hallelujah. Search my heart, Lord. Search my heart this morning, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. You know me better than I know myself. Hallelujah. You know the things that I think, Lord. You know the things that I say, Lord. When Pastor Boone is not around, hallelujah. You know the things that I do, Lord. That when nobody is in the church is there, Lord. You know the things that I do, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Empty me, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Empty me this morning, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Holy fire. Burn away my desires for anything that is not of you and is of me. I want more of you and less of me, yes. Holy fire, burn away my desires for anything that is not of you, yes, and Lord, is of me. I want more of you
fill, won't you fill me with you?
Lord, won't you
empty me?
Thank you, Jesus.
Empty me, yes. Fill, won't you fill me with you? Come on, one more time. Sing it for Jesus. Empty me. Empty me, yes. Fill, won't you fill me with you? Holy fire, burn away my desires for anything that is not of you and is of me. I want more of you and less of me, yes. Fill, won't you fill me with you?
Thank you, Jesus.
Empty me. Empty me, yes. Fill, won't you fill with you?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Glory
Thank
to
you,
God.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Thank Jesus.
You, Jesus. More of you, Lord.
Thank you,
yes.
Lord.
Hallelujah,
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer, yes he is. Yes, he is. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is. 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 Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is. 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 Yes. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah unto our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is. 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 Glory, hallelujah.
Grace and mercy, Lord. Thank you for saving me. I wouldn't be on no pulpit dancing. Woo! Thank you, Lord. God is awesome. He's awesome and he's worthy to be praised. He is worthy to be praised. Every day we open our eyes and see another day, God is worthy to be praised. All day, every day. He is, and he is, and he will be, and always, God. I thank God for who he is. Men wouldn't forgive me, but God did. I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Men can't be trusted, but we could trust God with everything we have. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. I'm here to introduce the speaker. He's no stranger. We all know him from Ustream to YouTube to Facebook, we know him. He's our pastor, our teacher. He belongs to us. Sorry, everybody else. And he give us the word, and we eat, and we get fed very well by the word in here. So if we don't know the word, don't blame it on the pastor. Blame it on yourself. Yes, but thank God for him. I thank God for him, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be ignorant still. But thank God I'm a little bit wiser than I was before I came. But without further ado, I'm going to introduce to some and present to others none other than our own pastor, Pastor Samuel D. Boone. Thank you.
Amen, amen. All right. Praise God. This is a Thanksgiving season, isn't it? So much to be thankful for. Amen. God has been good, and he's good all the time, isn't he? Such a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Savior we serve. Amen. If you have your program or your Bibles, let us go to the Word of God. We're coming from the book of St. John, in the 5th chapter of St. John, in the 5th verse through the 15th verse. St. John, 5th chapter, 5th through the 15th verse. We ask you to stand for the reading of our scripture. And it reads, "And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, Will thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the water, but while I am coming, another step down before me. Jesus said unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, is the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. And he answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed was not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. And afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee. And the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. Amen. Let's remain standing for a moment of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank you for this moment and for this hour, Lord, to be used as an instrument in your hand and unto your glory and unto your praise. Lord, open unto us the words of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Let your word go forth, let it edify, let it build up, let it encourage, Father, we pray. We ask this all in the name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Father, for what we're going to receive from you today. And we praise you in Jesus' name. And let the church say, amen. The title of our lesson this morning is God Wants You Well. Amen. We give honor to the Spirit of Christ. Deacons, saints, and friends, we thank God for each and everyone making it out today to be in the house of worship. Ain't it so good that God wants something good for you? Ain't it good? You always like people who like to give you something good, don't you? I don't know too many people who hate a person who want to see you get better, want to see you have more, want to see you grow, want to see things prosper. And you know anybody like that? Jesus is like that, ain't he? He always wanting something good for you. That's why I can't understand why people don't like him, why people won't serve him. When he's only coming for what you need, something for your good, huh? Most likely it's going to be better than where you are. Most likely it's going to do something more than you ever had done for you before. It's going to be something that you're going to definitely appreciate. You're definitely going to like it. You're going to love it. You're going to say, man, boy, I wish I would have been here years ago, huh? If I knew about this years ago, I'd stopped years ago and jumped on this path. But you know, some folks don't know that. God wants things better for you. God, I don't care, even if you think you're doing good, God say you can do better. Huh? That's one good thing about God. He ain't status quo. Huh? He don't leave it on the same level. Huh? If you was there last year, I expect it to be more next year. Huh? God don't ever expect us to be status quo or to be stationary or not progressing or not prospering. God always wants you to be moving on, moving forward, and never going back. Huh? And the last thing he wants you to do is to stand still. And wherever you done got to, don't lose that position. Hold that spot to yourself. You know, but I'm so glad about the way God feel about me. But there are some folks don't feel nothing but for me, but some bad things. And I say, Lord, I don't want to avoid them people. Because everything God do good for me, they got something bad to say about it. You ever see some folks, they ain't appreciative of what God has done for you? Ain't got nothing good to say about what God has done for you. And they always talking to you about, well, he might have did it this time, but he ain't going to do it again, huh? They always thinking of something bad. But I'm here to tell you, if he did it once, he'll do it again. Huh? He don't put no number check on his blessings. He don't put a number check on what he's going to do or how many times he's going to do it. God is, like he tells about forgiveness, he said, don't number it. In fact, it's got to be beyond your number. If somebody asks you for forgiveness, you got to do what? Forgive them. Amen. And so I want to just tell you about some of the things that the Old Testament tells you about how God wants you well. In fact, if you look at the book of Psalms, the 103rd division of Psalm, in verses 2 and 3, it says this here. It says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities and heals all your diseases. Huh? The Living Bible says it this way. Yes, I will bless the Lord and not forget the glorious things he's done for me. I don't want to forget him. Huh? The blessings and the things that he said, I won't forget what the Lord has done for me. Another thing he tells us, he said, he sent his word to heal them in the book of Psalms 107, verses 19 through verse 20. It says, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distresses. He sent his word and healed them
and delivered them from their destruction, huh? Just in a sitting of his word, huh? That was deliverance, that was healing, huh? That was blessing. He said he sent this word and he healed them and delivered them from all their destruction. I found the antidote for destruction right there, huh? I found the antidote for my disease right there, huh? His word, huh? He said, just put that word at it and it'll stop it, huh? It'll cure it, huh? He sent his word and he stopped it, huh? Then another thing about his word, the power of his word. We need to know about that. In Isaiah 55 and verses 10 through 11, it says, "For as the rain comes down, and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater." He says, "So shall my word that go forth from my mouth, it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the things for which I sent it." But I'm going to tell you something. That's God speaking there. Do you know that? That's God saying. He said, "I sent my word and it healed him." And then he said, "Well, my word goes out of my mouth, it does not return unto me void, empty, failure, huh? Not accomplishing the things that I sent it to do." But he said, "It's going to accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper or succeed in the thing for which I sent it." I just need to know that there's power in the word of God, huh? If you don't know that, you need to find that out. That's a benefit. God said, "Just speak the word," huh? And that's what the centurion told him. Just speak the word and my servant shall be healed, huh? Then in Exodus, the 23rd chapter and the 25th verse, God says this here, how he gonna take away our sickness. He say, "So you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water, and I will" what? "Take sickness away from the midst of you," huh? God said, "I'll take away your sickness," huh? Then it says this here. I like it in the Message Bible. Message Bible, but it breaks it out. He said, "But you serve your God, and he'll bless your food and your water, and he'll get rid of sickness from among you." How many of y'all want sickness to get away from you, huh? Just serve God. If you serve God, he said, "I'll get rid of it from you. I'll bless your food. I'll bless your water. In other words, I'll sustain you," huh? Then in the book of Deuteronomy 7, verses 14 and 15, it said this here, "You shall be blessed above all people. There shall not be a male or female barren among you or among your livestock. And the Lord will take away from you all sickness and will afflict you with none of the terrible diseases of Egypt which you have known." But guess what he's going to do with them? "But I will lay them all on those who hate you." better look out. Something can come on you, Jimmy. Because he said, "I'll take that sickness off for you, and I'll put it on them," huh? God will do that. He did it because when Naboth came to Elijah, he came all full of leprosy. And Elijah said, "Look, go down there to the River Jordan and dip yourself seven times, and you'll come forth clean." But Elijah's servant, and God, Elijah was trying to set an example. "I don't need to be paid because I didn't heal nobody. All I did was gave him God's word. God's word did the work. God's word did the healing. God's word worked the life in him," huh? And he said, "But I want some of them suits. I want some of that stuff he given." And so when he took it, the God did that same thing that God had on Elijah, on Naboth, took it and put it on him. He became leprous because he just couldn't receive God's word. Some things you just leave it alone. God said, "Just don't have nothing to do with that." And he's sitting around there trying to get something that God done told Elijah, "Don't take nothing from me because I don't want him to think that you're doing this here for money." That's what he was trying to set forth. But the thing is that this here, God say, "I'll take your sickness off of you." And them folks who talking about you, talking about she believe God, talking about she trust God, always leaning on God and talking about God, and that God said, "I'm going to take that sickness off of you." And them ones that's talking about you and hating you because you got healed, he said, "I'm going to take it off of you and put it on them." Guess what? When he put it on them, I know who they're going to call. They're going to call you. God going to them understand, healing comes through me, and the best person I want to heal is the one who talk about my God, who say, "My God can't heal no more, my God can't bless no more, my God can't do none of these things no more." I'm saying, "God, do something for it. Open up his eyes so he can see." He said, "I'll take it off of you and I'll put it on them that hate you. In the New Testament, it tells us you were healed as a past tense. In 1 Peter 2:24, it says, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin or died to sin, may live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. Some people say you are healed, but I say you were. It's past it. He already done paid for your healing. Your healing is already done. It's already been there. Accounted for. God said, look, I know Sam gonna get sick this day. Huh? Take a stripe for it. Huh? His healing is right now. All he gotta do is just accept it and receive it. Huh? He said, all your healing has been taken care of. Huh? I've already took the punishment. I've already took the stripe. He said, by his stripes, you were healed. And then the last verse, 3 John. In the second verse, it says this here, beloved, he said, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in what? Health, even as thy soul prosper. Huh? This is what kind of God we serve. You think he ain't looking out for your good? You think he ain't thinking out for what's best for you? Huh? This, you got to be crazy, because all his benefits are good benefits. I love him. Huh? He's always working things out for me. Huh? And so God wants you well, huh? He wants you whole. He wants you blessed, huh? God wants to see you through. You know, some people that, like I say, they like status quo. They don't want to change. It's always been done that way. And I found out those people who always sit in status quo and always say it's always done that way don't move. They don't change. But there's nothing in life that God has made remain the same. It either get older, it either become brand new, huh? It either get stronger, or it get weaker, huh? But it don't remain the same. It's always change. And the thing about it is here, are you where you, I'm sure you've asked everybody in this church, do you have everything you need? Do you have everything you want? Can God do a little bit more for you? Huh? God came to Solomon and he said, Solomon king now. He said, what can I do for you? Huh? If God asked you that question, do you have an answer for him? Sometimes I wonder, do you really have an answer? Because Solomon said, look here. He didn't ask it for gold. He didn't ask it for the death of his enemies. He just said, God, just give me some more wisdom that I can lead your people. You see, so God know you need something. But whatever you need, God said, what can I do for you? That's what I ask people. You know, a lot of times just asking a person, what can God do for you? That opens up their hearts and give you a way to channel to witness to a person. Because a lot of times I ask people, say, what can God do for you? They say, well, you know, I just went through a hard time in life. And all these things are beginning to happen to me. Then I begin to tell them how God can turn things around just at the snap of a finger. Do you believe that God can turn it around? Some folks think that it won't. It's going to always. I'm here to tell you, I don't know how many times I believe that in myself. It's going to always be like this. And I found out, fool me, that things change. I've been laid off from jobs. Thought I would never get another job. Got another job. I've been without cars. Thought I'd never get another car. Got another car. I've been in situations where I thought I would never come out. That's me thinking like that. But look at here. I found out it may be like that in your mind, but God done said some things over your life that you won't even accept it. You won't even believe it. The devil is trying to keep you from receiving it because you got this old blind spot to say, God can't do that for me. Can God make a river in the desert? I'm here to tell you, he can. God can set up a table in the presence of your enemies and he'll feed you while they saying, how you eating? And there's a famine in the land. God said, look, there's a famine in the land, but in your hand, I'm protecting you. You're going to eat. You're going to get water. And there's not going to come up a lack in your life. I read in the book of the word where it said, where Isaac, it said a great famine came and Isaac wanted to go back to Egypt. God said, don't you leave. You stay right here. I'm going to take care of you. And the Bible said he sold and he got 100-fold from his sowing. And that was during the time of a famine. We serve that kind of God. He's always looking out for your benefit. He want to see that you get well. And like I say, you can stay right where you are and be perfectly content, and you can. Because you see, Paul said, I learned. But don't misunderstand him when he said that. He said, I've learned to be content in whatever state I'm in. I'm not mad with God when I don't get what I want. I'm not upset with him when he don't come through when I think he should come through. I don't get mad and pout and do like some of these children, drop down on the floor, act like a kicking and scrapping and hollering. I don't get mad with him, huh? Because when I was doing good, I was happy with him. So why shouldn't I be happy with him when sometimes I don't get everything I want? And he's still God to me. My attitude towards him don't change. You see, because if you're living because of the blessings and your attitude is only good towards God because you got everything you want and everything's being done the way you like it, then you like God. But when the things change on you, like the devil told Job, he said, look at here, God, he just only serving you because you blessed him. You got a hedge around him. He said, but you take that away from him. He said, I'll make him cuss you to the face. He didn't know Job heart. God knew Job heart. If God didn't know his heart, he wouldn't have never gave him that in the first place. And I'm here to tell you, he gives it to you because you can receive it. And because you receive it, because you love him. Ain't the things that I have, it's the love in my heart that I have for God. God blesses me because I love him. God looks out for me because I love him. God heals me because I love him. God opened up doors for me because I love him. I put him first before anybody else. I don't care what you say about my God. I don't care how you treat my God. He's first in my life. You can call me this and you can do that to me, but he's first in my life. And because he knows he got first place in my life, guess what he does for me? Hey, brother, look at you. If you first place on God's list, whoo, he's not gonna do the good things. He's overly thinking about you. He concerned about you when you don't even know it. He said, oh God. Sometimes I just thank him. Sometimes he goes overboard. Hey, God ever went overboard for you sometimes? Hey, he ever went overboard? Sometimes you say to yourself, man, hey, you didn't have to do that. But I ain't giving it back. I ain't gonna give it back. I thank you. Like I told Sister the other day, she showed me a computer and she gave me the money. I wasn't expecting the money. I was just looking for the computer. And she said, well, I thought you get the whole. I said, well, she ain't gonna give it back to you. I'm gonna take it all. Even though I had a monitor. But I don't give nothing back. You give it. I figured God wanted me to have it. Even if I got one, I'll take two. Amen. Y'all looking at Pastor Craig. That's all right. God's good. Go to our text, and it says, in the fifth verse, a certain man was there which had an infirmity, it says 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, will thou be made whole? And the impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but when I am coming another step down before me. Huh? Let's think of this man's condition. If you go up a little further, especially if you go up in that second and third verse of that same chapter, it says, now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches, and in these lay a great multitude of impotent folks, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. And the thing is this here. You see the desperate needs of the world. There are some folks, they blind, they want to see. There are some folks, they lame, and they want to walk. There are some folks, they're withered, and they're deformed, and some of them even paralyzed. They want to be made whole. There are some folks that they don't have enough, and they're without, they're poor, and they need things, huh? And the thing about it, this is so many things that going on in the world, and God is the answer, huh? That's the thing about it, huh? These folks, you know, it gets me sometimes about people, how men will always grasp for the wrong thing to help them, huh? They all hanging around a pool, looking for some trembling of the water, or looking for some supernatural thing to happen in their life. All of them around the pool. I mean, the blind around the pool. I mean, the lame around the pool. Everybody looking for some supernatural power to happen in the water. And if there's supernatural powers that happen, they'll lose their illness. But I'm here to tell you that there ain't no water, shaking water, that's going to take away your blindness. Now, there ain't no shaking water that's going to take away your paralyzation. There is no shaking water that's going to take away your disease. But people will crowd up, line up for something that's not the answer, but they'll do it anyway, huh? The thing is that this here, folks going out for looking at, I know you've seen them, those hands on the streets. People looking for some answers, and they ride around looking for some hand signs on the streets. There are some people that they're always looking at their horoscopes, saying, well, my horoscope say I'm gonna have a bad day today, and I ain't going out the house. Believing more in their horoscope. There are some people looking for signs in the skies, looking for the stars to tell them something. But you know, all that they looking for ain't gonna give them the answer that they're needing, huh? They're going out the things that, like the Bible say, there's a way that seems right unto the man, but the end thereof is the way of death. That's in Proverbs 22. Going a little ahead of my sisters over there, huh? But anyhow, the thing is this here. He's sitting there, and the thing about this man that I admire is to try to pursue something that you can't get from nobody else, but you don't want to be in that predicament. You understand what I'm saying? He didn't accept his condition as status quo, huh? I know it's been 38 years, but I'm still looking for healing, huh? Ain't that something? Because some folks would have gave up after maybe a month or two, but he had a determination, and I got to give him credit for it. For 38 years, he said, I'm looking for a healing. They remind me of the woman with the issue of blood. For 12 years, she spent all that she had because she was not going to be satisfied with status quo. I got to live like this. I got to be in this predicament. She knew there has to be a healing. If there's a sickness, guarantee you that's a healing, huh? If that's a problem, guarantee you that's a resolution, huh? And this man felt like, shoot, 38 years ain't convinced him that, brother, it ain't no better than this, huh? 38 years ain't convinced him what the use of trying to get up there anymore. 38 years ain't convinced him. You see, I'm gonna tell you something. I hope to God I got this kind of persistence when it comes to opposition. I hope to God I got this kind of position when the devil is coming against me and things are not looking like I'm not going to give up because it don't look right. I'm not going to give up because I'm at a disadvantage, but I'm going to trust God and his word. Somebody that told this man, there's a healing. He going so far as to looking for a water to share. I don't know if I'd hung around a pool 38 years, but I'm going to tell you something. What make you comfortable in your predicament if you hang around people in your predicament? When you start hanging around people in your predicament, that makes you comfortable to stay that way. If you hang around folks who don't want nothing, you'll be comfortable not having nothing. If you hang around folks who don't want to go nowhere, you'll be comfortable not going nowhere. If you hang around folks who love to be sick, you'll be comfortable in your sickness. That's what keep people a lot of time as status quo. Who's your company? Who's hanging around you? I used to thank God for the friends I had. They never would let me stay status quo. They would see me sometime, and they would say to me, look, I saw you could do better than this. I would look at my buddies. They would never want to get promoted. They always wanted to stay where they were, status quo. And they would come to me and say, boom, you better than that, man. You going on take that test, and you'll get more, and you'll get promoted. And he would never let me stop until I took the test and got promoted. And then when I saw that, he said, look, Boone, you better than that. Take the test, get promoted again. Take the test, get promoted. They wouldn't ever let me be satisfied as status quo. They always say, you can do better than this. You as a child of God, if God always see you as the better, how can you say you are all right? How can you say that you got it all together when God can always see you as the better? He comes to you you sometime in your worstest moment and say, hell, you great warrior, and you shaking in a wine press, so scared you can't even throw your wheat out there in the open because you're afraid somebody bully gonna come and take your food. And God walks up to you while you in that fearful condition and say, hey, you old great mighty warrior. And you so shocked to hear those words until you say, who, me? Yes, you, great mighty warrior. Some of the things God says about us, it should shock us. What? You, me? Yes, you great mighty warrior. You overcome. You the one that got the power of God in your life. What you doing sitting in that position, all shaken up and worried and fearful, and don't know that you got the power on your side? I believe the devil is happy. I believe he's happy when you sit up there and accept your condition as being status quo. I believe the devil is clapping his hand. I believe he's having a party. You know how they say, when one sinner repented, all the angels in heaven rejoice. I believe the devil rejoiced when one of God's people forget him and forget to believe what he can do for him. I believe he get out and he have a party. He say, look, she ain't going to call on her God. She ain't going to pray to her God. She's too broken down. She's too hurt. She can't come out of that depressed state. Look at her. Just sitting now with the Holy Ghost sitting in her life and won't get up out of that condition, just down there moping. Well, you don't know how bad I feel, and just moaning and groaning about herself, and got the power to come out. God is good, ain't he? Oh, look here. Yeah, this man told Jesus in that 7th verse, he said, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the water. But while I'm coming, another step. See, that's why we sometimes we put too much trust in man and what man's supposed to do for us. And that's why we always getting somebody in front of us. That's why we always coming up a step short. Because we putting our trust in man. And when you put your trust in man, man will let you down. I'm pretty sure I got a witness in this church where some folks have liked you today and hated you the next day. I'm pretty sure I got a witness here. Some folks have supported you today and put you down the next day. I'm sure I got a witness. But see, one thing about our God, he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He don't change because you do wrong. He don't change because you ain't faithful. He don't change. The Bible says you could be unfaithful, but he gonna still be faithful. You could be bad, but he gonna still be good. That's the kind of God I serve. Your actions, your reactions doesn't change him. How you do and what you say doesn't make a difference with Jesus. I'm gonna be still loving you when you don't love me. I'm gonna still help you when you won't help me. God is that away. Good gracious, I said, Lord, help me. Because a lot of times, you know, you wanna say to folks, you didn't help me when I was doing bad. I don't want to help you. I got an opportunity now to help you, but I don't want to help you. Because I remember how you did me. But you see, the God ain't like that. God don't hold records of things like that. God loves us so. He said, I want to do you good even when you're doing good. And even if you didn't help me, I'm going to still help you out. Because why? That's the kind of God that we serve. And then the Bible said this. It said, in that 6th verse, said, when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been there a long time in that case, he said, and will thou be made whole. God knows your condition, know your situation. He knows everything about you. You know, we go in prayer. We really actually, I used to think this way. I really actually think I'm telling God something he don't know. Huh? I really, when I go in prayer, I'm really thinking to myself, well, God, you don't know I need this. You don't know about this. You don't know about my sickness. You don't know about my pain. You don't know about my... I'm really on my knees thinking. I'm informing him about something. I'm not thinking in my mind that I'm really just doing what the word says. Huh? Taking all my cares and casting it upon him. That's not because he cares. But he already know my problem even before I ask him, the Bible say. He already know. And so the man... telling Jesus, and Jesus saw him, Jesus said, I know you've been in that state for a long time. But notice what he did. Remember what he said. He said, do you want to change? Huh? Do you around all these sick folk? Huh? Do you really want to leave these sick folk? Huh? Because you know, some of us, we have a hard time leaving our friends. Some folks who ain't doing us no good. And we still want to hang with them. Ain't helping us out, ain't showing us nothing right, ain't giving us anything, but we still want to hang with them, huh? He said, do you want to be made whole, huh? Do you want to come out of, because I'm going to tell you something. God knows our state, and he knows our condition, and then God reaches out to help us, huh? He's there to help, huh? And so he said, look, do you want to be made whole? And he gives him that long, drawn-out, pitiful story. Somebody always stepping. Don't you get tired of people stepping in front of you? Huh? It should have been mine, but somebody stepped in front of me. Huh? I should have got by somebody. I was almost, but somebody. You should be tired. If anything will frustrate you, is to be in a long line, done waited there for hours, and you right there at the desk now, and you get ready to come, and then they'll bring somebody and put them right there in front of you, huh? I don't care if it's the manager, I'm about ready to jump on it, boy, because I done been waiting all this time, and I done finally got to the desk, and now you tell me, hold up, sir, we got somebody in here, we got to bring them up here. Oh, no, you wait till I go, then you bring them, huh? I get tired of that, and you should get frustrated. Jesus, try to let this man know, look, I know your frustration, I know what's going on in your life, huh? But the thing is this here, he said, somebody always step down before me. Now, look at this, what Jesus says to him. I want you to see the power of the Lord, but I want you to see it in another way. Look at what it says. Look at verse 89. Do you have it? It says this here. And Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. Woo! Now, that's a significant point here. I want you to notice one thing about this here. Jesus did not pronounce a word of healing. He didn't say, thou art made whole. He didn't pronounce not one word of healing. Huh? He just said, merely commanding the man to act. Huh? And then the man did not know he was healed until he obeyed the command the Lord gave him. And another point, in the act, the man was to show his faith. If he believed, he would arise and walk. If he did not believe, he would simply continue to lay there and continue just as he was all before. Huh? See, just to say, look, let's see how bad you want to get in out of that condition. And see, the thing is, he didn't tell him nothing and he didn't know nothing. He just said, rise, take up the bed and walk. Now, look at here. So one thing I found out when people say, I got faith, faith without works is dead. You can talk to me about Abraham, you can talk to me about Isaac, and you can talk to me about Jacob, but I'm watching you. How much are you acting on the word of God? How much is you taking God at his word? Because see, faith without actions is dead. I can tell you all day long what God can do for you, but until you put it into operation in your life, it won't do nothing for you, huh? And see, the thing is, Jesus said, look, I know your condition, I know all about your situation, but look, do you really want to change? Do you really want to change in your life? And the thing is, the only thing that can change our lives is the power of God. When God says something in his word and you accept that thing in your life, brother, that thing begin to make a change in your life. I read in the Bible, say, as we read God's word and as we get that word into us, it's like a mirror. It begins to change us. It begins to conform us unto being just like him. But that only happens when you start accepting and acting meditating on that word? Have you seen the change in your life when you take God at his word and you begin to act on that word? I've seen my change. Brother, look here. Some things I've done, I said to myself, where did this come from? Step right there on the lot and say, I want this car. Jump right on the plane saying, I'm going way over to Africa. Where did that faith come from? Acting on the word of God. I can't ask for the possible. He said, I got to ask for the impossible. And when I put it in that condition, then I got to put God with it. Because with man, it's not possible. But with God, all things are possible. God want me to walk in the impossible. I can't do that on my own. I need God with me. I found that out. Situations that I don't know how to get out of. Things that I never thought I would do. I said, Jesus, and it happened. I said, Jesus. Some people look at me and say, how did that boy do that? How did he get that? I say, with God, that's how it works. And God will do it. But he want to know, are you willing to change? You want to be ecstatic. You can lay down there. I'm going to tell y'all something else. People talk about me. I say, all right. They talk about my blessings too. I say, that's all right. They talk about what God had given me. And I say, that's all right. Because, see, you can't talk if I ain't got it. Huh? You can't talk if God didn't bless me with it. And, but God's doing it. And as long as God's doing it, and I'm recognizing it's from him, I'm going to be proud. I'm going to be thankful. I'm going to rejoice. Because why? God did it for me. Sometimes I just look in my lifetime. I done turned 60, y'all. But I'm thankful for what God has done in these years. These 41 years. I ain't talking about those 19 that I didn't know him. I'm talking about them 41 that I knew him. He had did some great changes in my life. You see, it's a simple act God is asking this man. Huh? And I'm going to tell you something. As difficult as it looks, 38 years, paralyzed. That's a simple act he's asking him to do. This is what I love about God. He ain't going to ask you nothing as difficult is what your state is for you to do. That is it. I mean, 38 years, paralyzed. All he say, get up. You mean that's all that's been happening to me? I'm not getting up. You mean that's all that's happening to me? I'm just not getting up. I'm just laying here and relaxing. Because that's what he was doing when Jesus came. He was just laying there relaxing. And God said, look, your problem is you need to what? Get up, wake up, or jump up, something. But you need to change. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I can't stop talking about, think about that. 38 years and all I had to do was get up. Lord, can you see it? Peter walking in the temple at the gate that's beautiful, and this man that been sitting up there for 30-something years, and everybody know him, and he got his regular cup and his bowls, and he asking for change. As you come and give chink, 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 change. Come on, give some change, huh? And here come Peter coming through there, and Peter done walked through there many years and then heard that man say the same thing, change, chip, chip, change, give me some change. But the change that Peter was going to give him wasn't silver and gold. Oh yeah, I got some change for you, but it ain't gold and it ain't silver. What I got for you is Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. I'm sitting here waiting for change for 38 years, silver and gold, and Peter say the change you need is Jesus. Once Jesus jumped into that man's life, the Bible say he jumped up and went leaping and bounding and running and rejoicing in the temple. You mean all I needed to do was believe on Jesus and a change would have happened? He said, look, all the man had to do was one simple act, that ninth verse, and immediately the man was made whole, took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath day. Oh, Lord, have mercy. That would be such an amazement to have dealt with something that long and
to be through with it forever. Huh? You know some things if you've gone through in your life and when God finally bring you out, good gracious, I sometimes wonder what did that boy feel like? Hey, he got this bed in his hand that he been laying on for all these years. He got his feet that he couldn't move and he walking all these years. He got everything. And Jesus just said, get up. That's all you got to do. Just get up. And he got, brother, look at him. I'm going to tell you something. Opposition always come against your blessings now. Try to get you to take back that which God done for you. Try to get you to talk against it. But God is too good. Let's look at that verse 10 through 13. And it says this here. It said, look, the Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, it's the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, he that made me whole, the same said unto me, take up thy bed and walk. And they asked him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed was not who it was. For Jesus had conveyed himself away in multitude being in that place. Look at here. This man's so happy. He forgot to ask Jesus what your name is. I thought that one. How can he let that man got away? That man then got me up off of 38. You don't even know his name. Brother, I'm going to tell you something. You get so happy sometimes you forget to say, God, thank you. You so glad. You just running around and just. Somebody say, well, what happened? You know, oh, wait a minute. I forgot to go back to tell that preacher for laying his hands on me in the name of Jesus and God healing my body. I forgot to go back and tell him, thank you. I forgot to go over there and call on the name of Jesus, just praise him for all the things that he did. Now, I'm down that 38 years. I'm sure I'm gonna grab you. I'm going to grab you. I'm going to hug you. You ain't going to just get away from me. I'm going to hold you for a little while. Look at here. This is too. I'm going to be like the man with Peter and John in the temple. I'm going to hold on to you while we going in the temple together. But he didn't even know. He was so glad. He just took his commandment and just walked. And the people say, look, who is it? I often say to this about God. I say, God, I don't never want my eyes so closed that I can't see you. Huh? I don't never want my ears so dull that I can't hear you. Huh? Because, you see, it ain't always going to be so obvious that you see God working for you. Huh? But always keep your eyes on him. No matter what's going on in your life, just keep your eyes on him because he's working it out for you. The Bible says all things are working together for the good, that them that love God, that them that are called according to him. He's working something out for you. And it's going to be something good for you. You may not see it today. I done seen so many days where I thought God had to forgot about me, but he didn't. I done seen so many times when it looked like it was all it, but it wasn't. But God can do it. And the thing is that this here, these dead religious people, instead of them asking the question about, man, who did that for you? They ask them two questions that doesn't even make sense. They say, who? They say, it was not that who is the man who healed you, but who is the man that told you to break the Sabbath day? Huh? I sometimes wonder, a man born blind, and you sitting up there looking at him, and you trying to say, no, you couldn't have been blind. You a liar. I know, but the man said, look, one thing I know. He said, whereas I was blind, now I can see. He said, I know I was blind, but he said, but now my eyes are open, and I know that that thing that used to keep me in the dark, it's been moved out of my life, and God has brought light into my life. Look at here. One thing about your testimony. I want to say this too. When you got a true testimony, all your haters, all your enemies may talk at you and talk you down, but they can't talk you out of a true testimony. Because brother, when God's done something for you and you know he done it for you, I don't care how many devils come out of here. I don't care how many demons come from around here. You can't talk me out of that testimony. Brother, I don't care if you're the priest. I don't care if you this or that. You can't take my testimony. Because look at you. All the devil want to do is take your testimony. Your testimony is what's keeping you standing against the wiles of the devil. Your testimony is taking you through all your persecution and your trial. Your testimony. I know God saved me. I know God brought me out. I know God promised me this. And I know God is true to his word.
word. You can't make him out of a liar. You can't change his promises. You can't cause him to go back on his word, because he's God, and I know he's true for what he said. Them old dead religion people, they should have known that only God could heal somebody that's paralyzed 38 years. But you can get so in the dark, so blind, so caught up in your religion, until you forget about God. You forget about the power of God. And the thing is, they around here worried about their little Sabbath day. He broke our Sabbath day. That sort of reminded me of somebody say, girl got saved, but she wasn't dressed right. She can't be saved. She ain't dressed right. How God gonna come in her life if she dressed like that? God showed me something years ago. There was a lady came into the church, and she was drunk as a skunk. I smelled the alcohol when she walked past me. You know, some folks, they done drunk so to the alcohol cologne is in their skin, huh? She walked past, and she was drunk as a skunk, huh? And she sat in the church, and the pastor called for the prayer line. I'm a deacon at this time. She comes up, gets into the prayer line. She's about to fall. She's just that drunk. And I'm saying to myself, oh, Lord, what kind of person is this? You know how we all us all holy, done forgot our days of can't standing up, huh? But how in the world could she come into the house of God drunk as a skunk and dare to get into the prayer line at that? All that, I'm just talking, all that foolishness running in my head, not seeing that this is God at work, because I'm just so holier than thou. And brother, when she got into that prayer line and the preacher laid his hands on her and pray for her, this is the amazement of, I'm going to show you how God's power is. God kicked all that alcohol out of her, filled her with the Holy Spirit right there. She was speaking in tongues, all delivered, all sobered up. I say, what? You understand? All that talking I'm doing and all that bad mouthing of God and all that bad mouthing of that lady, huh? God was working all the time. God brought her there. See, she had went through a tragic situation in her life, and she was feeling so bad she didn't think of nothing to do with the drink. And she said she came by the church and she just saw the church and some told her just come on in. And when she came in, she got delivered. You see, you tell God, take them blinds off of my eyes. I want to see you working. I don't want to start seeing things as they are, but I want to see how you can work it out, how you can do things. You see, don't put a God in no box, and don't limit God, because why are you thinking God can't save somebody drunk? God will show you, I'll not only do that, I'll sober them up. Oh Lord, that I never forgot that spirit. But brother, look here, God can work on some things that people be saying can't be done. God will do it. And so the thing is, the man said this here, I don't know his name, but he told me, look, pick up your bed and walk. Now I'm gonna tell y'all, this is what I wrote down. Sabbath or no Sabbath, I was commanded to take up my bed and bulk you, your friends, your chaplain, and whoever, your law, your doctrine. He said, pick up my bed and walk. I was there for 38 years. I was there in that condition. And I didn't think about no Sabbath. I was thinking about what he said. Pick up your bed and walk. You see, some things you just got to just put it to the side. Y'all can say what y'all want to say. I know what I needed, and I know what he gave me. He said, pick up your bed and walk. And he wasn't thinking about the Sabbath. And guess what? I ain't going to think about the Sabbath. Because look at here. I'm not going back to where I were. I'm going forward. I'm walking. I was laying down, but I'm walking. I used to couldn't pick up nothing, but I'm carrying the thing that used to carry me. I don't care nothing about your Sabbath or what you believe or you don't believe. I know what he said, and I was glad to do it. Because look at here. Well, I know it's going to change me. It is going to make me better. Look at here. You and your doctrines can go. I'm going to follow his word. folks sitting right there looking at God, working on people, saving people, delivering people, healing people, and they sit up there talking about, well, he ain't no good. He came there and prayed for y'all in the hospital with tennis shoes on. How is God going to heal somebody and he walking in there with tennis shoes on? Because that's sometimes my sister get on me about that. You a preacher. Why don't you wear your robe? Down? Oh, no. Y'all don't like Brother Boone when he come in with his tennis shoes on, his blue jeans, and his little shirt. Because I'm going to tell you something. Collar or no preacher collar. Ain't gonna do nothing for you if you don't believe in the healing power of God. I'll walk in there with my tennis shoes on, and I look around, I see all everybody, all of them, they got their suits on and they peach collar on. I walk in there and I say, well, Lord, you know. I'm just gonna do what your words say. Say, anointing in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And if he's done anything, it's going to be forgiven. And God's going to what? Raise him up. Look here. I know that's what you want. You don't want no preacher going to come in there all fixed up, but he ain't going to raise you up. You want somebody that's going to come now who's going to pray in the name of Jesus and believe that God's going to what? Going to raise you up. Ready head on a t-shirt. Ready head on a preacher collar. Ready head on a pair of shoes. All you know is that he raised me up. I got up out of that condition. God delivered me from that. That's all you need. Sometimes we get caught up in these old fair fashions and all that. No. But I say Jesus was so natural and so normal. I say to myself, I say he couldn't even pick him out in the crowd. Because the Bible says he looked around, he didn't see him. You would have thought Jesus would have had on a big white robe. Huh? Big straw, big hat on top of his head, looking like the Pope. But he must look like just like everybody else. Nobody, but he had something that nobody else had. That make the difference. Huh? Let him close this out. Look at verse 14 and 15. It says, afterwards, Jesus finds him, and I want you to pay attention to this here. Four things Jesus told this young man to do. Jesus finds him in the temple. It says unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more. Lest a worse thing come upon you. Now, I want you to understand something. When God do something for you, God requires you to do something for him. Look here. He told this man four things. And I'm going to tell you something. It's your responsibility as a believer. The first thing this man did, he said he found him where? In the temple. Huh? Now, in the house of God. If God done took me out the street, done took me out the sick house, done took me off of drugs, guess where he gonna find me now? He gonna find me in the temple. He gonna find me where I should be, worshiping him and thanking him for what he done for me. You would have thought that he'd have went back home, but the Bible says he went to the temple. Jesus finds him in the temple. That's your responsibility. Go to church. Give God some time. You wouldn't give him no time. You would give all that time to the world, but not give him some time. Another thing he said, the thing that was done for you, he said, I want you to remember. Look at here. Say, find him in the temple. Say, unto him, say, behold, thou art made whole. You don't forget this. Don't forget what God, you see, sometimes when God make us whole, we forget. But he said, look here, I don't want you to forget who brought you out. I don't want you to forget who healed you. Don't want you to forget. Know that when you didn't have the money, you got it now. Don't want you to forget. Know who got you out of that situation when you thought you couldn't get out of it. I don't want you to forget. He read it in the Old Testament. God always told him, set up a memorial for what I just done for you. I always remember what Joshua did when he crossed the Jordan River. He said, look, in the middle of the river, build a memorial up to what God has done for us. In the middle, while the water was still held up on the other end, God said, put something there. Let you know that I was here, and that I was here on dry ground. Then when you get over on the other side, he said, I want you to build a memorial letting you know I brought you across that you couldn't cross on your own. I opened up the way that you couldn't open up the way on your own. I want you to remember. I remember, look here, I'm so glad. I remember when the Lord saved me. I remember when the Lord blessed me. I remember when the Lord brought me out. I remember when the Lord forgave me, because I sure enough need a lot of forgiveness. I remember when the Lord said to me, look, move forward, go on, don't stop here. I remember a lot of times when I was broke down, hard hurt, and thought I'd never get up on my feet again, and he brought me back. I remember. I ain't gonna forget him. I definitely remember him on the day of communion. He said, remember me when you take that bread and wine. Remember, I'm coming back. And I believe God's soon to come back. He said, remember, you were sick now, but now you're whole. Remember that thou art made whole. Then he said, what? This is your duty. Don't you go and sin no more. You'd be surprised how many physically crippled or diseased people are that way because of some sin that they committed. I remember I had a friend, and he went out and he wanted to go, you know, like I guess like the boy did, but he didn't have $75,000, but he had a few dollars. Went out there and got him some prostitutes. And one time, and caught HIV, and it took him out within 6 months. Huh? One time. Huh? You understand? Just because of that one sin. Some people are in wheelchairs because of some sin. Some people are in predicaments. Some people laid up in hospitals because of some sin. Huh? I was listening to the TV Saturday. This girl, she was paralyzed from the neck down. She said her and her friend were partying. Coming back from the party, they had an accident. And she was sitting in the back seat of the car. She said the car, when it rolled over, she was all right. But then when it swung around and hit the tree, where it hit the tree at was right where she was sitting by the door. And it broke her spinal cord. And she was paralyzed from the neck down. Now, they was out drinking and partying, having themselves a good time. But I guarantee you today, she wish she'd have never got in that car, never took that drink, all because of some sin. Now she paralyzed. You'd be surprised. So Jesus said, "Now I want you to understand, it was a sin probably that got him in that position, got him in that position for 38 years. He said, look, I want you to go and sin no more. God don't save us so we can go and sin some more. God saves us so we can go and don't sin no more. Look at here. God didn't save you so you can cuss better. Some folks, they say they saved and they out cussing the sinner. What? What kind of tongue you got? You definitely didn't get the Holy Ghost speaking in tongue, and you cussing more than everybody else. God didn't save us so we can hate people more than people out there in the world hate each other. That ain't the kind of spirit. It was a spirit of love. You're supposed to love your enemies. God didn't give us a spirit where we go out and lie and cheat. You're supposed to tell the truth. That's the kind of spirit he gave. He said, look, I want you to go out there and a dinner. I don't want you to sin no more. And the reason he said this here, he said, look, I'm going to give you a judgment. He said, less or worse thing come upon you. You see, take him for granted if you want. Use him up if you want. And I often wonder, I say, why did he say least or worse thing come upon you? I can't hardly think of nothing worse than what he went through, can you? But is this something worse than that? You can die and go to hell. Huh? That's what he was talking about. He wasn't talking about you getting another condition or another sickness. He's talking about you can lose your soul. You can go to hell. And once you go to hell, that's the worst you can get. You stand around here and you take it lightly what God's doing for you. You stand around here and you don't appreciate what God's doing for you. You stand around here and you don't repent. You don't change. You don't do the thing that you know you need to do because you know God is calling you. You know God is working on you. But you don't do what he say. He said, less a worse thing come upon you. There's some people in hell. God done did some things for them. And they say they just counted it as nothing. But when they looked up in hell, they said, look, I should have went back to church. I should have gave my life to the Lord. I should have repented. That's the worst thing. I ain't talking about another kind of disease. I ain't talking about another kind of sickness. I'm talking about something that you can't get out of. And God ain't going to bring you out of it. When you get to hell, that's it for you. Your chances are up. You can't change your circumstance. God can't change nothing for you. Once you get in hell, you're lost. You can pray all you want. You can call all you want. You won't get your prayers answered for you. That's what he was talking about. Some folks say, well, you can, I'm thinking, I said, well, what could be worse? Folks that's blind, folks that's lame, folks that's paralyzed. What could be worse? Hell. That's what came to me. Damnation. That's what he's talking about. You taking what God's doing for you and you just pushing it to the side. You going on doing what you want to do and ain't thinking about what God done did for you. And you counting it as nothing. Yes, that's something worse out there. That's something out there that you don't want to meet. Something out there that you don't want to come in contact with. I've seen so many things that God have done for so many people and some of them have died. And I say to myself, I say, Lord have mercy. Didn't he think God was doing all these things for him to keep living that kind of life? God wasn't doing it for that. God was doing it to save his soul, to change his life. Not only the physical healing is good, being brought from poor to rich is good, huh? Being brought from darkness to light is good. But what you gonna do when you get in the light? What you gonna do when God done brought you out? What you gonna do? Are you gonna go back where you came from? Moses told the children of Israel, he said, when y'all get in that land and y'all begin to receive all the blessings of the Lord, he said, don't forget. Huh? Who did it for you? Don't forget who put you in that house. Don't forget who put you in that car. Don't forget who's feeding you every day. Don't forget who waking you up every morning. Don't you forget who saved your soul. Don't you forget what he's done for you, huh? Yeah, Lord, I said, Lord, I thank you. I thank you. You see, the world may reject him because they don't know him, but I know him. And I love him. And I know he want me well. He want me whole. He want me to have whatever his son has. He want me to be joint heirs with his son. And the only way I can get that is I got to act on his word. I got to believe him for what he said. He said in Romans, we got to have to say it, Romans 10. It's right here in his word. Romans 10. And we're going to start from verse 8. We're going to read down to verse 10. It said, but what says? Say, the word is nigh thee, is even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead. He said, thou shalt be saved. He said, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That's God's promise to every sinner man and every sinner woman. All he's asking you to do is just believe. Turn away from your sins and turn to him. And he'll wash you whiter than snow. Invitation is there. Is there anyone who need prayer this morning? Anyone need salvation this morning? God is here. Give you what you need. God want to see you. If you're sick, he want to see you well. If you're not saved, God want to see you saved. If you're lacking anything, God want to fill up that lack and overflow it. If you need help, God's there to give you some help. Huh? Whatever you need this morning, God has it. Is there anyone this morning? If not, we're going to stand and pray. Those who are on Ustream and Facebook heard this ministry. We're glad for your support. But we'll be more happier with your soul and say, we're here today because being called, God wants us to reach out to the lost. That's our main objective. God wants to see you get well. He wants to see you whole. Let us lift hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we've spoken your word. We did what you commanded us to do. Father, now that word that gone out, let it land on good soil, fertile soil, that it'll take effect in the lives of those who hear it, that it'll bring about a change in their heart and in their mind, that it will strengthen their faith, that it will bring deliverance from their bondage, that it will give peace to their troubles, that it will resolve their problems in the name of Jesus. Lord, as your word go forth, touch it, men, women, young men, young women, everywhere, Father, let that word settle in their hearts, bring about a change in their life. Father, we know in your word, you said it. You came to save that which was lost. And Lord, you died on the cross, shed your precious blood in order that we might be saved. Lord, save those who are listening to this program through the different technology. Father, let the word touch their hearts and change their lives. Any here among us that's sick, Lord, touch and heal them. Any among us that's troubled, Lord, give them peace. Father, let the peoples know within their hearts you got what's best for them. And you want to see them the way you know they should be. Lord, take away the unbelief. Take away the lack. Take away the laziness. Father, put a fervent spirit, a zeal in their hearts and their minds, Lord, to study your word, to know you better, to get closer to you. We pray and we ask this all in the name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you for what we've received today from you. In Jesus' name, and let the church say amen.